Thank you. So this is about it is about GADT. So this is quite clearly the opposite of just the previous talk. The idea is that there's no need to check dynamically for things in OCaml because you have GADTs and all your checks can be done statically. But this supposes that you need some support for the language to be able to do that. Okay. Okay, so, well, the GADTs, I don't think I have much to say about it. Everybody in this room knows about GADTs. The basic idea are just that algebraic data type with different type parameters, so you see the different case. This is, we use almost the same notation as in Cox, so it should not be hard to follow for people who are rather from this background. So you can express proofs, invariants and proofs. So in OCaml we have this since 2012. The most important aspect, of course, of GADTs is how they behave with pattern matching. So the point is that when you do pattern matching with GADTs, you introduce local equations. Here we have an example with the plus tab interpreter with, well, int introduce the equation A equal int, add introduce the equation A equal int. And app will introduce a local existential variable. And we are using here polymorphic recursion. GADTs are strongly connected with pattern matching, and this is why we get to the main story of this talk, which is about GADTs and exhaustiveness. That is, usually, exhaustiveness, GADT introduced not power vector test. Exhaustiveness is just checking that for each constructor appearing in the pattern matching, all the other constructors belonging to the same data type are also matched. So actually, the exhaustiveness check can be quite complicated in its implementation, but the idea is relatively simple. You don't have to look at types at all when you do exhaustiveness check. Just maybe type definitions, but. And with GADTs, actually, we can do more, because then the types can be used to refine the information. And the classical example is, suppose that I have this GADT with case int and case bool. And the idea is that if I tell you that this function g is only taking as input an int t, then I know that it can only receive the constructor int. So there is no need to do any check at runtime, actually. And OCaml does that. That is it. It sees that bool is impossible, discards it, so you don't have a non-exhaustive merge warning. And when it compiles it, actually, it discards everything. And there's no computation to do here. So it's quite essential to have that with GADTs. And this process can be rather subtle. So if you think of other cases, here this case is, suppose you have a function that takes two parameters, and you force them to have the same type index. So now when you're pattern matching on the two arguments, actually you know that they should be either, so this is an example from the previous slide, they should be either both int t or both bool t. So what you see here that if one is int, the other must be int. So the combination int bool will not be compatible with the type constraints we have here. So OCaml detects this properly. But you have even stranger cases. And here is something that may look contrary, but actually it's something closer that can happen, really. So suppose that here I have this deep function, which does something quite quite static. It's just receiving a char t option. And my definition of t, I have only an int on bool cases, OK? No char cases. So is it basically that char t is an empty type. So the char t option, of course, cannot have a sum case. So here, it's enough to handle the known case. But until now, OCaml didn't detect that. And we'll see later why. But just this case might sound, well, kind of silly, but there are more useful cases where this occurs. Here is another classical example where I use vectors with a fixed length. So here I have an encoding of natural number with 0 and such. And now my vector is a list with the second type parameter is an index because we need the length of the vector. And I have then the notion of variable, which appears in such a context. So I have one variable that is an index of a context. So the context must be, of course, of length longer than the index of the variable. So if it's 0, it must be at least length 1, etc. This is the intent of this definition. So when I want to do lookup, then just it's sufficient to have set lookup to have this definition. So I'm taking a vector of length n, a variable which has then an index which is guaranteed to be smaller than n, and then I should be statically guaranteed to be able to access this variable in this context. Okay, fine. If I write the pattern matching this way, this works. Okay, but maybe you realize that the thing slightly strange in pattern matching. I'm receiving my context and my variable. So first the context, which is a sequence, and the variable. But then I pattern matching in the opposite order. Why so? Because in the current version of OCaml, if I change the order, it tells me that it's not exhaustive. So type checking goes through, but it tells me that it's not exhaustive, which is quite uncomfortable. And well, we got bad reports for this kind of situations. Okay, so to understand what's going on, we should look at what OCaml is doing about exhaustiveness check for GADTs. So we've been handling that since the beginning, and the original algorithm. What we've done to handle GADT is just that the organism of exhaustiveness check in OCaml provide you with one counterexample, which is a nice thing, and then it tells you that you are pattern matching not exhaustive, but if it doesn't give you a counterexample, you're a bit at a loss. So what we did with Jacques Lenormand, my co-author, was to modify this algorithm, which was pretty easy, to give not just one counterexample, but all the counterexamples, all the missing cases. And once you've got all the missing cases, what you can do, which is relatively easy, is you're going to feedback all them one by one to the type checker and check whether they are really possible or not. And actually, well, that's not a thing to do. Haskell 8 should be doing that next year, since they are not doing it yet. But what happens then is realize, I told you how the exhaustiveness check works usually. It looks at all the constructors which are in your different cases, and it starts generating the other cases. But then it means that in the case of the deep case, actually, I had only none. So there is no GADT constructors around at all. So you cannot keep up that it would work. My second example with the symmetry problem is a bit different, is that the type checking is going from left to right. So when you're typing on the left, it doesn't know yet that it should be more restrictive. But the same thing happens. Then it starts generating the nil, okay? It sees a cone, so it says it should try with a nil. Then nil is a completely different case. So it's going to try with nil and a wildcat pattern. Since all the other cases. And again, the wildcat pattern contains no GADT at all, so you cannot see that there's any contradiction there. Okay. Before I get into how to solve that problem, I want to talk just a bit, because we're talking problem OCaml, and realize that what I've said in the previous page is not quite sufficient to handle exhaustiveness with GADTs, because we must be careful about what's going to happen. Clearly we want to be sound. As I told you, OCaml is using the exhaustiveness information for optimizations to get leaner code, faster code. Then you don't want to get it wrong, and there is a major source of wrong choices for about that. False negative, I should say. That is due to abstraction. Okay, I think I've told that today in a workshop before. The idea, take this type which has an EQ case and any case. The EQ case is it's the left case, so the two parameters are equal, and the any case is free. So consider here, I have this A function, which is taking an A and a B. And if you look at the interface of module A and B has two abstract types, distinct abstract types in the interface. So clearly for unification, they are not compatible. And so I say, since they are not compatible, then the EQ case shouldn't ever occur. So is this exhaustive? Well, clearly no, because if you look at the definition of A, you see that A is exporting basically something of type A, B, C, and T, and it can do it because internally, actually, these two types are equal. So the whether two types are equal or not is contextual in ML. Okay. So what we should we do about that? Well, what we do is that we need to use a different relation. So when you are typing patterns, actually, we don't use the usual definition of type equality, but actually we use type incompatibility to be sure that two types are distinct and be able to discard cases. Okay. Now, back to my best main subject, what is the essence of the problem of GDT exhaustiveness? Actually, as we've seen with deep, or to another level with our asymmetric case, is that when checking for GDT exhaustiveness, we end up having to decide whether a given type is inhabited or not. Which is actually a rather hard problem, because, well, if we were able to do that, then we could check for exhaustiveness in a complete way, if this were decidable. But in practice, what we've seen is that even if we limit ourselves to terms built from data type constructor, which is, well, the nice things in ML is that since we have called by value, pattern matching only working on values built from constructors, even in that case, inhabitedness is undecidable. And we can see that because we can encode home clauses as GADTs. And they appear to be equivalent, actually. So what are home clauses for people who have no Prolog background? So they are the basis of Prolog. Basically, they are predicates. Your predicate is defined. So you have an implication. So P of T is defined, P of T, if all these conditions are satisfied. You could have several clauses for the same P. And usually what you do in Prolog is that you check the clauses one by one to know whether it's possible, it's true or not. So how are you going to do your encoding? It's rather trivial, actually. Just reverse the side of the arrow, because in Prolog we write it from right to left, but in type we write it from left to right. Since we were using ML syntax, the parameters are going to be on the left and on the right. But, so once you've got all the things in the reverse order, you've got actually the same definition. Because a GAD constructor is just telling you that with all these type P1, P1, you can create something of type P. And what happens? What do we know about this? Because home clause, of course, I was to read. We know that a probability of the given goal, PU, is semi-decidable. So if there is a proof, it will be, there is a procedure that will eventually prove it. But if there is no proof, proof search may go on forever. So as the result, existence of a finite term of type UP is only semi-decidable, you could say worse, that exhaustiveness is about the non-existence of such a term, so it's undecidable from the beginning. What does it mean? It looks bad. It looks pretty bad. I mean, we've got an undecidable problem in our pattern matching exhaustiveness search check. What can we do about it? Well, sure, it's undecidable, but Prolog is a programming language that you use to work on undecidable problems, and so on. and it works. So what do you do? Well, we are going at, we can at least try. Try for a limited amount of time, so limited depth, the idea. Try a bounded proof search, and what we use there, we can use directly for log SMD resolution. So embed prolog in a camel type checker. To implement it, I thought about it, am I going to write a prolog in Python? Of course not. Of course not. We are a functional programming language, so what you do is convert the function, the type checking patterns, and since I want to type check patterns with backtracking inside, so what I'm doing is that I'm going to convert it to CPS, and then I am going to backtrack when I'm enumerating patterns, and then I'm going to type check and enumerate patterns simultaneously. So the idea, the basic idea here, is if I have something for a what is a counterexample of the exhaustive next check? So I'm doing the exhaustive next check as usual, not special one for the APs, that I get a list of counterexamples that I can pack them all together as a big OR pattern. Okay, there might be sub OR patterns if I want to be more efficient. And then I'm going to run the type checking function, but it's a slightly modified type checking function. When it meets an OR pattern, it sets the state and it tries all the branches until it finds a successful one, and it backtracks before trying the next one. Okay. And the other thing we are going to want to do proof search. So when it reaches a wildcard node, which is a variable node, okay, what it's going to do, it looks at the infer type. And if the infer type is a GADT, it's going to basically explode this GADT into all its cases. And again, backtrack between the different cases. So you can do an exhaustive proof search. There is one condition, it is purely a heuristic condition, so the current implementation just explodes one from the root of the pattern. No more than one, because of course the problem is undecidable, and we don't want to use too much time just for this check. Okay. So here is this slide actually shows the algorithm itself. It's in the abstract, I think. I have no time to explain it in detail, because this is what I've explained on the previous slide, basically. So let's look at a few examples about how this works in practice. So these examples are mostly proof related. Here, trivial case. Suppose I have the relational definition of addition here, and the trivial case is it possible to add 1, 0, and is the result of adding 1 and 0, 0? Well, of course not. And actually, it does not match any of the cases. Clearly not. So it means that it's saying unlimited known is exhaustive. Next cases, same thing. While I say it's easy or not trivial, it's actually you have to do a unification between the two last. Okay, you're going to the plus s doesn't work. The plus zero works, but then you have to unify 0, 7, 0, and of course it fails. So this one is impossible too. So again. The case known is sufficient. And when it gets other, is on this case, we have 0, 6, 0, 6, 0, 6. So what you're doing is doing you have to call the, you try the plus S case. If you try the plus S case, you go back to the easy case, actually. You get to the easy case, but as I told you, I'm using the heuristic of only exploding it once. So actually, we are not going to do the next step. So actually, the check is going to fail here. We are in this stable case, so it wants to stop somewhere. Slightly different example. What's happening here? I have addition. I'm adding A, B, and C. A, B, and D. And this A plus B plus D equal to 0, what are the possible cases? And actually, by case analysis, you can see that you can only be both plus 0, so that everything is going to be 0. And again, here, it will see that only this case is possible. So this was for exhaustiveness. You have the dual of exhaustiveness, which is detection of unused cases. Actually, it took me a while to do this, and I only did that yesterday, because it took me a long time to find the functions which was to be modified, because, well, Luke did a great work as a pattern matching checks, but the algorithm are getting more and more complex. So I found it actually by looking at the oldest version of OCaml, where the code was much simpler. and it was basically big text that you don't need the last case. And I almost finished. So that this all works, but basically the main issue is how deep should we go? So I told you about this heuristic, this kind of works. But do we want to go further? Is it already too much? Do you need a way to express that? Other languages have other ways to do that. For instance, in English, you have this concept of empty patterns, where you say that here, nothing, you cannot have any value there, and then it tries to check it. The trouble, I think, with this approach for a programming language is actually you have to enumerate all the cases to have this to work. And there can be lots of cases. Another way would be to have either a parameter file matching or to the file saying how do you want to try there. Another question is, should we also explode non-JIT types? In particular, tuples. Currently, I don't do that, but if you have only one case, maybe it makes sense to try to get deeper, because there could be a JIT behind them. So these are things like that. And also, do we really have to try as hard on redundancy? Because redundancy can be rather expensive. Not know. So I have a small benchmark. I tried a small benchmark with a different case. So the baseline exhaustiveness, like it was done until now, the first line. Kamel internal format is the only in the this Kamel distribution, the only file which used very heavily JDTs. Then if you try both exhaustiveness and unused but without exploding anything, you get the second line. If you try just to explode things, just exhaustiveness, it's not without, it's with exploding emptiness, okay? You get the third line, and if you try both, you get the fourth line, and you realize that, well, for Kamel internal format, this makes a big difference. For STD, but it's not. For, if you make all of Kamel, basically, say, at the total is maximum 3% difference, but the only goal is GADT, so there is a discussion whether it's worth it or not. Okay, I'm finished. So I implemented a strengthening of mean time relationship for JDT is no Kamel. It's not complete, this is undecimal, but well, it really helps in some concrete case, in particular asymmetrical behavior. And you can find the code there. Beware that the code URL is the current abstract on the workshop page is wrong. So here is the right one. And I need your feedback from people, for example, to see how much is needed. Yes, so actually the case of asymmetry was my main concern. So you can explain why this one currently, why this one works and this one doesn't, but it's really in terms of the, because type checking is from left to right, and you have to understand really how exhaustiveness and agency is done to understand what's happening here. My reasoning is that if we do just a bit more, probably the other case won't happen in practice, because my counter examples are really about proofs. They are not really about problems. But not to be sure. In this case, add one line saying, I want to search, yep. And this would mean, okay. Yeah, this would be an option too. But this doesn't work for redundancy. I don't know anything about Clock. For Agda, my understanding is that really you must write the empty pattern exactly at the position where you're checking. So it means that in practice you're expanding all the cases already.